Underground and in the sky, animals and birds who live nearby. Larry used to be this shanty made of scraps dragged deep into the woods. But when another homeless man moved on and left a tent behind, Larry and Mike moved in. The campsite is near North Charleston City Hall. North Charleston police have discovered at least 24 homeless camps, one within sight of a North Charleston elementary school. More than 100 men and women live in these camps.
Anytime we're doing a point in time come, it's just a snapshot. It's not the actual picture of what's out there. We were just able to find 144 persons.
White is a volunteer with the Continuum of Care, an agency which counted homeless camps for the government back in January. The count was made in the early morning hours with the help of police.
Titus usually sleeps on that right there.
North Charleston is making an effort to clean up the camps. Most are on private property and are considered a hazard. It could mean a trip to jail when the trespassers are discovered. So when police show up, the homeless disappear. It's a tough way to live.
I don't like being back here. I don't like living in the woods. I don't like being dirty.
Being dirty makes it hard to hold down a job. A shelter could offer a shower and a place to sleep, but
if they're not full, they want to charge you. You know, they want to charge you, like $15 a week.
So a tree is his closet, his belongings minimal. In the woods, entertainment amounts to polishing off a few pages and a few bottles. The trash piles up. What comes in doesn't go out, so most camps look like a dump. There is help, so they don't really have to live this way.
Be it medical assistance, drug addiction, alcohol abuse, spousal abuse. So those services are provided to them.
Services they may not know about or may not want. White says most of the homeless work. Larry and Mike sign up for day labor. Jobs have been scarce. Odd jobs may bring them $10 a day. They wonder what's ahead.
Build that billionaire jail. That'll build a nice homeless place.
Yeah, they're spending a lot of money on a jail, but they won't spend money to build shelters. You know, to help the homeless people.
Surely we can raise money to shelter animals. We can do the same thing for human beings.
Human beings who escape into the woods at night. A solution in some communities, churches opening their doors. White believes it's a model that could work here.
They've opened their doors like on a weekly basis to have families come and stay. And the particular church that houses these people on a weekly basis, they provide the meals and the beds. The shelters are overflowing and there's not enough room to house everyone.
Since mid-January, this has been a school day ritual for Marjorie Dawson, walking her daughter to and from Sanders Clyde Elementary School.
Thank you. Have a good night now.
To the place this mom and daughter temporarily call home.
Whoa, be careful.
It's only a couple of blocks away through the traffic to the Crisis Ministries.
I have to write sentences with 10 of my spelling words.
Ajali's homework from the third school she's attended in the last year.
I've been in Chicago, Gowan Elementary, and Sanders Clyde.
The 8-year-old says it's not fun moving from house to house and not fun changing schools.
I'm not used to the people who's in the classroom with me or the teacher.
Her mom didn't know it may have been possible to keep her daughter in her original school.
Getting her into school, I had to have proof of residency.
But a federal law protects Ajali and all school-aged children who don't have a permanent home. It gives them the right to stay in their school of origin, and the district will help when it can with transportation. The children also get school supplies and uniforms.
They gave her two blouses and a pant, and they did give her, this notebook and, pencils, everything necessary stuff that she would have to have.
Sonia Jones helps homeless students in Charleston County Schools. She says hardships at home often mean students have trouble in school.
tend to not have homework assignments, missing work, not having school supplies, or can't find their work because they're constantly moving. And a lot of times they just back out in class.
That's not the case for Audjali, who's an amazing little girl.
I don't know, because I think I do good when I take tests and stuff like that.
She wants to be a doctor when she grows up, and her interim grades show she's working hard.
Social studies, A, science, and A+.
Marjorie says her daughter comes first. She's trying to get a job and set up an apartment.
Actually, this is my first time ever in a situation like this.
Until now, they've had their own apartment or lived with family. Parents are often ashamed to tell the schools they're doubling up with friends or relatives, living in a hotel or campground or the car.
Because of the economy now, we've seen a large increase in families who have been evicted.
Joan says the family should not be embarrassed. There are plenty of other folks in their shoes, and their kids can get a lot of services, including tutoring, even medical and dental care.
We want families to know we're here, we provide assistance. All things and what they used to be. What about this overcrowded land? How much more we use from sand? Can't you stand?